When I saw this initially on the Province article written by Patrick Johnston, published earlier this week, part of me was like, oh, of course. And the other part of me was kind of screaming inside, because just reading this one little sentence in the Patrick Johnston article kind of sparks emotions that I didn't really know that I had. Let's go over onto this article here, written on The Province. It is written by Patrick Johnston, published on July 1st. Patrick Johnston's Canucks bonuses plus flat cap make for mean cash crunch. And it goes over some Vancouver Canucks salary cap implications, all that stuff, money. We talked about the salary cap not going up a few videos ago, but this article here by Patrick Johnston goes over the Canucks implications of that. And he talks about Loui Eriksson. Because, of course, if you're going to talk about Vancouver Canucks money, you're going to have to talk about Eriksson. The guy's the highest paid player on the team, or at least he's in a three-way tie for that title. And he was signed for that $6 million cap hit for 6 years, and that was at a time where he was somewhat valuable. But immediately after making his debut, he was really not that kind of player, living up to the contract that he signed just a few months prior to. The thing is, though, Patrick Johnston writes about Eriksson in this article, and he writes a sentence that kinda just catches everybody off guard. It may be a surprise to some, it may not be a surprise to others, but here it is. Eriksson was nearly traded to the Edmonton Oilers 2 years ago, but he nixed the move at the time. Huh? Eriksson was almost traded to the Oilers in 2018, but he wasn't traded, because Eriksson ultimately said, nah fam, we're not doing that. Back in 2017-2018, Loui Eriksson's contract had a no-move stipulation. No-move, we talked about this in the Eriksson contract termination video from just over a week ago. That was the Terminator thumbnail. That was the thumbnail that I had probably the most fun making in my entire career of making thumbnails, and everybody else seemed to like it too. No move means no move. It means no AHL. It means no waivers. It means no trades unless the player says yes. And 2 years ago, Eriksson would have had the right to say, nah fam, we're not doing that. You're not trading me to Edmonton. So what Patrick Johnston writes about here, where it says that Jim Benning was going to do it and he had a plan in place, but it was ultimately nixed because Eriksson said no, kind of puts a whole different light on the entire Eriksson contract now, doesn't it? Eriksson's contract would have been 2 years done by then. It's 4 years done now, and we still have two more years to go. Loui Eriksson was a player who Vancouver Canucks fans criticized for a very good part over the past 4 years, especially in the past 2 years. So now, just taking a look at this, we have confirmation that apparently, as far back as 2 years ago, Jim Benning was willing to and trying to get rid of this player. All of a sudden, the entire Elias Pettersson saga is changed. No more Loui Eriksson in 2018-19, no more Eriksson in 2019-20. This guy wouldn't be on that shutdown line with Bo Horvat and Tanner Pearson for pretty much the entirety of the 2019-20 year before Toffoli came in. All of a sudden, the entire past 2 years worth of Canucks hockey is different, because the Canucks would have had a different hole, they would have had to fill that with another player, whoever that player was. Maybe, I'm just hypothesizing, I don't know if it's too big of an ask, but that player would have probably been a little bit more valuable than Eriksson on the ice. But of course, that's just me talking about the possibility of not having Eriksson. The thing is, if you're thinking about an Oilers trade with Eriksson, there was pretty much only one player at the time who actually would have made sense to come back, and that was Milan Lucic. We know what happened with Lucic. He was a guy who was eventually traded to the Flames for James Neal. There were some draft pick stipulations in that trade, and James Neal ultimately became a good scorer with the Oilers, but Lucic just became Lucic on the Flames. So that probably would have been the return. If not, any of the other expensive players they had back then, and they did have expensive players in 2018. Draisaitl, McDavid, obviously those two, you're not going to get those two in the trade with Eriksson, but they were expensive, not to mention Nugent Hopkins, who had a $6 million cap hit, followed by Andre Sekera, yeah, remember him, at 5.5, Oscar Klefbom at 4.1, Adam Larsson 4.1, Chris Russell at $4 million, and then you also had Cam Talbot at $4 million too, and Benoit Pouliot, who is on a buyout history of 1.3 for the next 3 years. There were definitely some options here, and if the Vancouver Canucks wanted to get a little bit more, let's just say, flamboyant with it, They could have indeed maybe added a draft pick or a prospect or something of value in order to get somebody like a Sekera or, I don't know, a Chris Russell back instead of a Milan Lucic. Because when it comes to Lucic, even as far as a year ago at the 2019 draft, people were talking about Lucic and Eriksson and Neal. There was this whole trade rumor of a three-way trade between those guys because they all had similar cap hits. But ultimately, the cap implications of Loui Eriksson would not be too different if the team had Lucic instead. In fact, you could argue they would be worse. Lucic's contract goes on for a year longer than Eriksson's does, and it's also at $6.0 million a year. And I know, that's not taking into account salary bonuses and all that stuff, that's just the average annual value. Loui Eriksson is in a spot now where he is supposed to be getting paid his $3 million bonus, and he's owed like $5 million over the next year or two, something like that. So that's why the whole debate of the contract termination thing came up. But if it was instead a Milan Lucic on the Vancouver Canucks for the past two seasons, then I've got a few questions as to how these past 2 years would have gone. You can say what you want about Milan Lucic and how good he is at playing hockey, but the fact is the guy is an agitator still, and he's still capable of sticking up for teammates, laying the body, and being a physical presence. What would have happened if instead of having Loui Eriksson in the lineup against the Florida Panthers when Mike Matheson did his thing on Elias Pettersson, it was Lucic out there instead? What if instead of having Jesperi Kotkaniemi take down Pettersson, it was Lucic out there instead of Eriksson? What if instead of having Eriksson in the lineup on the night of the Tampa Bay Lightning game where Danique Martel came in and elbowed Troy Stetcher in the head? Yeah, you remember that game? I just brought up some bad memories, didn't I? What if it was Lucic out there instead? This is the kind of guy who would stick up for his buddies, especially as a Vancouver native playing for the Vancouver Canucks. You know that the passion runs deep within his blood. This is the guy who, in the long term, I know the cap situation would be bad, but at the very least in the short term, would we have seen justice in those situations? Now I know, lumping the Kotkaniemi thing in the same boat as the Matheson thing may not be the best. Kotkaniemi was kind of accidental, everybody admitted that, everybody knows that. But at the same time, once it happened in the moment, everybody was upset. So there's reason to believe that the players on the ice may have been upset too. Danique Martel and Troy Stetcher is just a completely different thing. That guy was never good enough to actually be an NHLer. He was just there for the purpose of causing a ruckus. That's what he did. And he instantly, overnight, became one of the most hated people in the entire city, just with that individual performance. But, you know, Lucic being out there probably would have changed at least some parts of that hockey game, and a few other parts of a few other hockey games too. It wouldn't just be Roussel out there causing a ruckus and getting up in people's faces, it would be Lucic too. And that's a dynamic that I honestly kind of envy the Edmonton Oilers for actually having over the past few years. Not that Roussel sucks at that, but it's just having more of that would not be a bad thing, in my opinion, in a city where, you know, fans and media take their players really seriously. They don't like seeing these guys get shoved around. So that's just some primer to think about. If there was no Loui Eriksson and instead if it was a Lucic, maybe my proposal from earlier goes true. And instead of it being Eriksson for Lucic one for one, it's Eriksson and a second for a Chris Russell or something. And the entire dynamic of the decor changes. But the bottom line is here, Patrick Johnston wrote about it in the article that, according to the sources, it was going to happen that Eriksson would have been traded. It's just that Eriksson himself nixed it. Oh man, the past 2 years could have been so much different, eh? So, talk to me in the comments below about Loui Eriksson. What do you think Lucic would have been like on this team? Sure, the long-term implications kind of look bad, but do you think it would have been a good thing to have that element in a few of those games? I certainly think it would be. Also on that note, is it even Lucic that comes back? I'd say that it was very likely that it was Lucic's name who was thrown into the deal, but of course you can't be too sure. So if you have any other ideas as to what could have happened, then you could leave that in the comment section below as well. Obviously, it's weird taking a look at the Eriksson contract, and I know every time I talk about it, it gets a big ruckus in the comments down below, because everybody kind of feels the same way towards that contract. But hey, you also have to take a look at how things are nowadays, because Eriksson today has a modified no-trade clause. He has a 15-team no-trade list, which means that the other 15 teams in the NHL are fair game. So if there's a deal out there for Eriksson, we may see that come out to fruition in the next few months, or, you know, we can still talk about that mutual contract termination thing. Not too sure how that goes, but we've got a long time to discuss the Eriksson contract, believe me. Two more long, long years, eh? So comment down below what you think about all this stuff. I hope you enjoyed this video. Social Network 99. And bye.